Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder at Luna Lake by Cathy Pickens, narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Chapter 1. A couple of county cop cars and several pickups, one loaded with an air compressor, crowded around the boat landing at Luna Lake. Pud Party, head of the county rescue squad, leaned against the front fender of a rust-red truck that sported a bumper winch. As I parked my dad's pickup truck alongside, Pud jabbed his elbow into the ribs of a tall kid propped beside him. Judging from their gaudy laughter, they were sharing some guy humor. Pud heaved himself upright as I strolled over. "Well, if it isn't Miss Avery Andrews, attorney at law." "Thought you boys were out here dragging the lake for a body," I said, tilting my head to stare up at Pud's unimpressive 5'8" height. "Looks more like open mic night at a comedy club." "You know how this business can be sometimes, Avery. If we didn't keep our sense of humor, pretty soon these dead bodies would get to us." Pud punched his companion in the ribs and cocked him a sly look. He hitched up his jeans and arced a stream of tobacco juice past the bumper of his truck, barely missing his young buddy's work boot. "Pud, get serious a minute. The sheriff sent word. She's holding Don Lee Griggs for murder? He's confessed to drowning P.V. Probert? So, you're defending Don Lee? Figured you would, him being so sweet on you and everything. He's always been partial to that red hair of yours." "I've always thought it more a burnished gold, but whatever. And Don Lee developed crushes on any female unwary enough to smile at him." "Yep," Pud sighed expansively. "He's a-sittin' around the table at Maylene's just last week, going on and on about how the overhead lights in the courtroom lit up your hair like golden sunshine." My eyes narrowed to slits, a look I practiced to cross-examine particularly loathsome witnesses. Didn't faze Pud, though. Up until 2 weeks ago, I hadn't seen Don Lee since high school. Then I'd been appointed to represent him in a bail hearing on a drunk and disorderly charge, an unusual place for a class reunion for sure. "Think you'll be able to get him off?" Pud asked. "Or will you two be carrying on your star-crossed love affair through a wire-mesh window?" That didn't deserve a response. I shoved my hands into my jacket pockets and mimicked his good old boy slouch, staring toward the lake and ignoring Pud. Something about this rescue scene didn't register as real, though the usual contingent of ghoulie boys were present, the rescue squad guys and police scanner junkies. One old boy dangled his legs off the tailgate of his truck while he finished off a bud. Another little clump included a couple of county deputies. Neither of them had missed many blue plate specials at Maylene's. In all, maybe 15 guys stood around in various poses, and all pretended they weren't sneaking glances in my direction. Something odd about their collective casual air. Or maybe I just expected more intensity at a murder scene. Don Lee had been stuffed into the back seat of a sheriff's cruiser parked at the far edge of the picnic area. His full moon face brightened when he caught my eye. He lifted his cuffed hands and actually waggled his fingers at me, flashing a gap-toothed grin. Don Lee had been a 6'7" goofball, even in high school. I'd received my share of "Do you love me? Check yes or no" notes shoved through the vents in my locker. I couldn't quite believe he'd killed somebody. But isn't that what folks always say? He never seemed like the type. I kept staring toward Don Lee, but didn't waggle my fingers back at him.
"You know why he committed this heinous act, don't you?"
Pud asked, feigning seriousness and trying to pretend he didn't see Don Lee make nose prints inside the cruiser window.
"Tragic, isn't it? It's his true love for you that drove him to it."
Pud's companion, a dark, lanky kid barely out of high school, snorted. When I turned my back on Don Lee to glare at him, he shifted his attention to a puddle of Pud's tobacco spit. At least my slit-eyed stare worked on somebody. But it didn't stop Pud. He just kept smiling.
He'd always liked a good joke, but I hadn't figured out the punchline on this one. Joking about this just seemed mean-spirited, so I ignored him. The Donna Karan suit I'd put on for my official lawyer visit with Don Lee wasn't heavy enough for an early morning visit to a boat landing. The November breeze off Luna Lake, which was really more of a pond, nipped through my silk blouse. Any idea where the body is or how long it might take to locate it? I tried to get Pud to focus on the fact that somebody had died. Anything to avoid having to consult with my client. It was just too sad. Pud kept staring and grinning and working his tobacco wad. The guys scattered in clusters around the lake's edge alternated between studying the water and sneaking looks over at us. They seemed to be eyeing us more than the activity on the lake. "Nope," Pud said. The breeze wasn't strong enough to push up waves. Bubbles appeared at regular intervals on the lake's dark surface. How long can those guys stay under there? Even the thought of it felt cold.
"Ah, they can swim all day with those suits. The ones freezing their arses off are those two numbskulls bobbing around in that boat out there."
In a two-seater flat-bottom johnboat, two men huddled in camouflage green jumpsuits and jackets. Every now and then, one would crane over the side as if he could see something in the greenish-brown water. Then, turtle-like, he'd poke his neck back into his coat collar.
"Those guys love it," Pud said. "Gives them a chance to practice."
Practice. He wasn't taking any of this seriously enough. My next question was cut off by the arrival of another pickup. It slid to a stop behind my truck. The newcomer's door popped loudly as it opened, then squawked shut. As soon as he slammed the door shut, I found myself face to face with the reportedly dead P.V. Probert.
"Pavey!"
Pud threw up his hands in mock surprise. He had shifted from comedian to dramatic actor in the time it took Peavy to slam his door.
"You're alive!" "Course I am, idiot. Heard y'all's dragging the lake. Come on the scanner. Found anything yet?"
"Actually," I observed wryly, "you're not supposed to be here." He jammed his hands on his skinny hips.
"Says who? It'd come over the scanner."
Like that was all the permission he needed.
"No, I meant you're not supposed to be here."
I pointed at the ground where we stood.
"You're supposed to be there."
With his lips pursed in his sun-dried face, Peavy's gaze followed my pointing finger to the lake. He stared for a few seconds at the small rivulets the breeze made on the lake and at the two guys sitting, like a couple of sillies, in the boat. Then he looked at me, as though he might need to put some distance between himself and a crazy person.
"What the—"
Pud couldn't hold it a second longer. Tobacco-stained spit spewed from his rubbery lips, and he doubled over as far as his protruding belly would allow, sounding like a Macy's parade balloon with the air hissing out of it. Pud guffawed.
"You ain't got sense enough to know you drowned, Peavy."
Peavy looked bewildered, but I was a few hundred yards ahead of Peavy on this one. Not that that was hard to do. "Don Lee Griggs apparently told these guys he drowned you in the lake," I explained.
"He never—"
Peavy's voice shrilled.
"No, he didn't, but he
called the dispatcher."
Pud pinched his thumb and forefinger across his eyes to wipe away tears of laughter.
"Told him he'd held a gun on you off the dock over there. Kept you swimming till you drowned. He said—"
Pud's voice cracked like a 12-year-old in church choir.
"He said it's over a woman."
Pud poked at his companion. The kid kept eyeing me nervously.
"That woman,"
Pud blurted, pointing at me.
Never.
As Peavy whirled on me, his indignation carried his voice up another octave. We'd drawn a crowd by this time. The rest of the crack law enforcement team who'd gathered around the boat ramp joined us for a close-up.
Don Lee said seeing Avery had rekindled the old high school romance.
Pud's eyes were streaming from the effort of his tale.
Said he needed to do something extraordinary to get her attention. Said a murder trial would let the two of them spend plenty of time together, preparing his defense and all.
Pud pulled a handkerchief with a fraying hem from his hip pocket and wiped his eyes.
Never,
Peavy announced, but less shrilly.
Thank you, Peavy, I said as graciously as I could. My cheeks were burning. I hoped it looked like windburn rather than humiliation. I'd skipped breakfast for a stupid prank. I couldn't be angry with Don Lee. He really was stupid. But Pud and some of the rest of this crew would pay. I didn't know how or when, but they'd pay. I felt like the village idiot, or, worse yet, like little Avery Andrews playing mommy dress-up. A gangly hometown kid, the brunt of a goofy, embarrassing joke. I might as well be making nose prints on the window myself. At least the rescue guys had gotten in some practice dives. Fuming, I turned toward my truck, careful not to sink my shoe heels on the gravel. Don Lee could stay locked in the back of the cruiser a while longer for all I cared. Sudden movement on the lake caught my attention. Two divers broke the water's surface about 50 feet out and swam furiously toward the boat ramp. Something about the urgency of their movements caught everyone's attention. Several men migrated toward the point where the two swimmers would come ashore. One of the fellows out in the boat fumbled with the tiny motor, trying to catch up with the divers. The two divers arrived practically together and flopped onto the rough ramp with a recklessness that surprised me considering they wore neoprene suits. That roughed-up concrete ramp could cut like broken glass. Carrying his fins, the first swimmer jerked his mask off, gasping, "A car!" he croaked. His mouthpiece swung against his chest as he duck-walked in his booties up the ramp. "A car down there!" The second diver had not joined the crowd on the ramp. Instead, he'd veered straight for the trash barrel chained to a pole at the lake's edge, flapping across the grass in his fins. He leaned over and vomited up his toenails with expressive, ungentlemanly sounds. The older diver, the one telling the story, turned a peculiar pea soup color around his lips and spoke louder, trying to drown out the sounds from the trash barrel.
"An old one, from the looks of it, at least a 70s model."
He swallowed hard and glanced at his flippers. His timing was flawless. His companion with the weak stomach ceased his retching at the same moment he announced,
"There's a body inside."
"A body?" The crowd shifted, glancing at each other, moving a half step closer in and closer to each other.
"Been there a while, I'd say, but it was..."
He paused and swallowed. Pud, who stood directly in front of him, took a step back, just in case the guy got queasy. The diver, his face pinched into a tight circle by his rubber hood, shook his head.
"It was... I've... never seen anything. It's like a skeleton, but it's covered in this yellowy-white stuff. Looks like soap. It's..."
The retching sounds at the barrel started up again, though weaker than before. My own stomach gave a slight heave. Some of the guys stared over their shoulders at the lake, their interest obvious. Others watched the older diver, now in the center of a loosely drawn circle. Everyone tried to ignore the guy at the barrel.
"We need to get that thing lifted,"
Pud announced.
"See what we got. Let me pull the truck down there, see if that winch can do the trick."
The crowd parted as those with something to do bustled about. The onlookers stared alternately at the lake or the ground, talking with a quiet animation. Not so secretly glad the show had taken a macabre turn. I counted quickly. The crowd had grown to about 30 ghoulie boys, a couple of trucks with volunteer fire stickers on them, some county cops, some passers-by, and a handful from the rescue squad. Not a lot of entertainment options on the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, I guess.
"I doubt that winch'll do it,"
the diver commented to nobody in particular as Pud maneuvered his truck front end forward onto the ramp. The younger diver, who'd been studying the inside of the trash barrel, now stood at limp attention beside the ramp. No one stood with him, whether to avoid his shame or the smell, it was hard to say. When Pud stopped his truck, the younger diver stepped forward to unhook the cable as Pud began to unwind the winch. Nobody interfered, anxious to let the guy redeem himself. The older diver waddled to the front of Pud's truck.
Somebody ought to radio for a wrecker, just in case. Oh, this'll pull a dump truck, Carl.
Pud huffed, bent over his task. That thing's mired up right bad in the mud there. I'm not too sure. Pud cut him off.
We'll give her a try.
The younger diver had already headed out into the water as the electric motor on the winch hummed, feeding out the cable. His partner shrugged, pulled his mask into place, took a couple of puffs on his mouthpiece, and flopped down the grass bank like a B-movie swamp creature returning to his own. Pud might have every confidence in the superiority of his equipment, but obviously not everyone shared his optimism. From a county car to my right, I heard background radio squawks interrupted by a deputy calling to town for a wrecker.
Well,
a drawling voice at my shoulder startled me. I'd been so focused on the figures disappearing under the murky water, trailing the wire cable, that I hadn't heard Dale Ernest come up behind me.
Mr. Ernest.
He missed a beat when I offered my hand. In Dacus, women don't offer to shake hands with their father's barber. It would take me a while to relearn the social norms.
Good to see you, Avery,
he said, clasping my hand in both of his. Your dad told me when he came in for a haircut last week that you'd be coming home. How very diplomatic. Dale Ernest had certainly heard about my coming home from sources other than my dad, sources less inclined to be charitable about the circumstances of my return. The quizzical look Mr. Ernest fixed on me and the gentle, saccharine politeness of his tone told me he knew more than my dad would have told him. The circumstances of my firing were too complicated to be adequately absorbed by the grapevine. So I wondered which tendrils had reached the cracked leather pump chairs in Mr. Ernest Barber's shop.
Came up to drain the water lines at the cabin, he said. Wasn't expecting this much excitement.
I smiled. I knew we'd both pretend that he knew nothing at all scandalous or questionable about me. A couple dozen cabins sat tucked back among the pines on needle-strewn winter weedy banks around a small, still lake. Luna Lake, only 20 minutes north of Dacus, serves as a busy weekend getaway in summer, but sits largely abandoned in winter.
Whoa!
A shout from the ramp stopped conversations in the clustered groups. Pud swung around and into the truck cab as fast as his bulk would allow to reach the brake. Pud's young buddy cut off the winch's motor and scuttled out of the way before the truck, on a slow slide toward the water, could run him down. Should have tied that thing off on a tree, Mr. Ernest observed.
Winch'll pull the truck underwater before it pulls that car out.
Pud got the truck stopped, and several of the ghouly boys gathered around to hatch another plan. Mr. Ernest nodded.
Don't use the cabin much anymore. Might not keep it. With so many outsiders coming in, I can probably get a good price for it.
I nodded. Mr. Ernest, his hands jammed into the pockets of his L.L. Bean jacket and his bald head shining in the weak sunlight, could have been mistaken for one of those retired outsiders until he opened his mouth. I hear tell you've moved into your granddad's cabin up here. He squinted at me. That a good idea? Well, it'll do until I decide on something more permanent. Mom and Dad tried to get me to stay with them, but the cabin needed some work. It's a nice change after living in Columbia.
You sure it's safe? Mr. Ernest asked bluntly. Not too many folks up here this time of year.
I'll be fine. I didn't elaborate. Years ago, my grandfather had not only taught me to shoot, he'd bought me a nice little SMW 38 and educated me on the advantages of hollow points. Mr. Ernest leaned against the hood of a county cop car, settling in to watch the lake.
You setting up practice in Dacus?
No, I'm just working out of Carlton Barner's office temporarily. To keep busy, I picked up court appointments and guardian ad litem cases that the county's other attorneys avoided like plague-ridden rats. I'd left Columbia a few weeks ago without a clear plan in mind, but with no reason to start a real job search until after the holidays. He nodded, staring at the lake. The winch whined weakly, straining to dislodge the car from its mud bed. Mr. Ernest didn't seem in any hurry to get about his business.
Funny, you and Melvin Bertram coming home at the same time.
Who? I settled back against the car hood next to him.
Melvin Bertram. You too young to remember him?
He sighed, his round belly shifting beneath his crossed arms.
He's been gone, I guess, 10 or 15 years now. Time sure has a way of getting away from you.
I nodded. The pace of conversation and most else in Dacus now struck me as odd. I'd been away almost 10 years to attend law school and then to practice law. In that time, I'd forgotten the circadian rhythms of my growing up, the paced conversations with deep currents. The pauses, in some cases, spoke more than words. He was saying something important. I waited, hoping I could hear it in the pauses. He continued,
"Yep, probably closer to 15 years. Were you gone by then?"
"In high school," I said. But Melvin Bertram's name rang only a faint bell with me. I studied the trees that rimmed the small lake, scarcely more than a shirt tail full of water, in my Aunt Letha's words. The leafless hardwoods sketched dark patterns against the watered blue sky. A half dozen docks jutted around the lake's rim, though the only boat visible was the rescue boat.
"Peculiar he'd come to mind,"
Mr. Ernest said, then sloughed off the topic like a too-warm overcoat. "How's your mama and daddy doing? Can't believe he decided to buy that old newspaper." I smiled, mostly to myself.
"Yep, he's been getting a lot of ribbing about that."
My father had surprised the Rotary Club one day by announcing that he'd bought the Clarion after a working life as a mechanical engineer. He says the paper's only assets are a bunch of old machinery, and he can keep that running as well as anybody. Mr. Ernest chuckled, his belly heaving.
"That's about true."
The rumbling arrival from Todd's wrecker service interrupted our slow conversation. Whoever had radioed into Dacus for a wrecker without giving Pud's winch a chance to prove itself had been wise. But before the wrecker could maneuver into place, Pud had to petulantly rewind his cable and back his truck out of the way, the tires spitting gravel. The spectators perched around, staring, like we didn't have anything better to do with our mid-morning. Which I didn't. I could have walked over to get Don Lee Griggs sprung from county detention. Don Lee's alleged victim stood a scant 20 yards from me, jeans riding low on his skinny hips and brown locks stringing over the neck of his grubby flannel shirt. So avoiding a murder charge would likely be a formality. But I wasn't in any hurry, especially since that goofball had planned all this just so I would rush to his aid. Pud's laughter still burned my ears. I really should make a phone call to assure that the wheels of justice began to grind, but I needed a little while to nurse my pique and my embarrassment. You really can't go home again. The wrecker kept feeding cable to the divers. I couldn't help being surprised at myself. True, the tense boredom and promise of drama here reminded me of a courtroom, but 2 weeks ago, I couldn't have imagined propping my rump against the hood of a car, staring across the lake and shooting the breeze with the guy who cuts my father's hair. I'd been too busy calculating billable hours and buzzing around Charleston or Columbia in my black BMW from lunch meetings to hearings to late-night preps for morning depositions. Killing an hour or two in the company of a bunch of county employees and police scanner addicts wouldn't have been on my agenda. Now I had nowhere to run, and not much to run around in since I had no leased BMW. My closet full of business suits hung in the only closet I could claim in my old room at my parents' house. The lake cabin boasted only wall pegs, and my most important client sat periodically stamping nose prints onto the window of a county cop car. The wrecker cable drew taut as the motor ground loudly. A few of the cops gathered at the bottom of the ramp, right where the wrecker would flatten them if its brakes failed. Out on the lake, the John boaters positioned themselves closer to shore. They wisely stayed a safe distance away from the taut cable as it disappeared into the water. The onlookers stared, most not speaking now. Several minutes went by, filled only by the sound of the winch and the intermittent squawk of two-way radios. Then the water at the base of the boat ramp churned. In a bubble of muddy water, the car's rear end appeared. Even with most of it still underwater, the car dwarfed the bobbing two-seater boat. The juxtaposition of the two objects jarred my senses. Cars aren't routinely resurrected from watery graves. Slowly, as the truck's winch continued to whine, more of the car lifted into view. The sheet metal had rusted to a mottled red-brown shade. The mud-caked tires hit the submerged end of the ramp. Johnny Black stopped the winch, leaving only the car's trunk and rooftop visible. The divers, belly floating beside the car, seemed to be checking its underside.
"Good thing it is right side up,"
one of the amateur rescue experts standing near me commented.
"Otherwise, they'd have had to flip that sucker in the water."
Several watchers drew in closer, in a tighter ring around the drama. Not close enough to get in the way, but eager not to miss any of the good stuff. One of the divers flipped a hand signal to the wrecker operator, who started pulling up cable again, slowly. The car inched up the ramp. Water streamed down the sides in muddy rivulets. Reddish-brown stains coated the window glass, leaving a color like someone had tried to wash away dried blood. Distinguishing between the rusty parts and the red mud was impossible. I'm no good at identifying makes and models, but the sedan sported a boxy, broad trunk and a mass of sheet metal that current gas mileage restrictions won't allow. A Thunderbird decal decorated the trunk. The car's rear end crept up the ramp. The onlookers craned, necks extended like vultures for a better look. The front seat wasn't yet visible. As the car emerged from the water, the front end canted sharply downward. But I didn't have to move for a better look. The car's passenger obliged me by floating into view against the rear window. I'll never look at a kid's magic eight ball in the same way again. Murky water filled the car. Inside, a shape floated into view, undefined at first. Then the face, or what remained of it, drew close to the window and took form through the murk. A human head. Not exactly a head, but not quite a skull either. A waxy yellow padding outlined the cheeks, jaw, and neck. The eye holes gaped, hollow and black. Floating limply, the head tilted. The grinning teeth tapped once against the glass. Then the apparition floated back into a shapeless form in the murk. The guy who'd been glad they hadn't had to flip the car clamped his hand over his mouth and stifled a gagging sound. Chapter 2. The unexpected resurrection at the lake must have unnerved me more than I realized, for I immediately made two mistakes, stopping by my parents' house and calling Sheriff L.J. Peters. L.J.'s guffaw, as soon as she heard my voice, told me she'd already learned about Donley and the invented drowning of P.V. Probert. P.V. himself had shown up at the detention center to ask Donley why he'd tried to drown him when he, P.V., hadn't even been at the lake. Then the two of them had headed off in P.V.'s pickup.
"Practically arm in arm," L.J. said. "Probably headed to Taps to celebrate Peavy's near-death experience."
Taps Pool Room, the bar where Don Lee worked and where Peavy regularly drank, and where Don Lee drank and alternately lost and remorsefully reclaimed his religion. They'll most likely both be back down here in detention by sometime tomorrow morning, LJ finished in a wry tone. I hoped Peavy was the only one drinking to celebrate that he hadn't drowned. I didn't want a late-night call from Don Lee. As soon as I hung up the phone on LJ's barking laughter, my mom corralled me. You finished, Avery? Then you can come with me to the Frank Dobbins Circle meeting. I don't. Those ladies would love to see you now that you're back in town. Some of them probably haven't seen you in years. I really need, and you're already dressed up, though you need to spot clean the hem of your jacket. Looks like you backed into something. She stuck the corner of a kitchen towel under the faucet, then proceeded to damp mop the back of my blazer. Mom, I really need to stop by the hardware store. She picked a couple of stray red gold hairs from my jacket. Staying up at that cabin isn't one of your better ideas, Avery. Lord only knows, though, you're as pig-headed as your grandfather ever had time to be. Anything could happen up there. Take that drowning this morning. Mom, nobody drowned this morning. A guy made the whole thing up. It was a joke. Still, that car with the body in it, that's not the kind of place you need to be staying by yourself. Who did they think it was? I don't know. I didn't want to think about it right now. I suppressed a shudder. The picture was too fresh in my mind and too gruesome. The drowning, I could believe she'd heard about. How she knew about the submerged car already was beyond me, though not much happens in Dacus that Mom doesn't know about, mostly through her various projects. Come to think of it, Don Lee Griggs had been one of her little projects. She and I would have to have a talk about that one of these days. But not right now. Right now, we were on our way out the door to the Frank Dobbins Circle meeting. I couldn't very well insist on driving, since I didn't have a car. Nothing made me question what would become of me more than reminders that I had no wheels. I'd have to attend to my lack of transportation. Probably sometime after I attended to my lack of gainful employment. Mom scooted through a yellow light in front of the Lutheran church and banked in a sweeping circle with several bags of aluminum cans rattling across the back of the minivan. She parked in a diagonal space beside the church, her front wheels perched on the sidewalk. I've never been certain what function the Frank Dobbins Circle meetings serve, or even who Frank had been. Mostly, it seemed, a group of ladies got together at each other's houses or in church social halls and chatted about books, ate cucumber sandwiches, and then, I assumed, spent the rest of the afternoon burping up cucumber. My mom, being a sensible woman, didn't seem to fit, but she went anyway. I suspected it enabled her to enlist the aid of these ladies, their Sunday school classes, and their husbands' checkbooks in her projects. You can't save the world without adequate resources. The cooing and chirping that greeted me fell in sharp contrast to the hands-in-the-pocket stares that had met me at Luna Lake that morning, but the arm-patting and polite comments masked some of the same kinds of questioning looks. The tallest woman in the room neither smiled nor genteelly patted arms. From her vantage point near the cut-glass punch bowl, she spotted us as soon as we came through the door. She set her collision course accordingly. The lesser ships floating in her path did little to impede her progress, but her salutation reached us before she did. Avery, glad you brought her, Emma. Seeing my great-aunt Letha in context other than family gatherings always brings the enormity of her into stark relief. Aunt Letha is a large person by any measure, but against lesser mortals, those less able to withstand her onslaught than her own family, she is formidable indeed. Letha is my mother's aunt. My great-grandmother died in childbirth while producing my grandfather, Avery Howe Hampton. 2 decades later, my great-grandfather remarried and sired 3 daughters, Aletha, Hattie, and Vinia. When my great-grandfather later buried his 2nd wife, Aletha assumed what all considered her birthright, the role of matriarch. She'd held the unelected office ever since. Aunt Letha, it's good to see you.
We don't waste a lot of time hugging in my family, and a handshake seemed particularly awkward, so I simply smiled.
Good thing you're here. Getting out's the best thing. Best thing to still wagging tongues.
Letha shot a look at a pillowy lady standing nearby in a tight print dress.
Afraid a mule's gonna kick you? Stand close to it. It'll still kick, but it won't hurt nearly as bad.
Letha said, not quietly. The pillowy lady's expression froze under her wiry gray curls. Like a possum caught in headlights, she couldn't even bring herself to scurry away. I had no idea what they'd been saying about me before I got there, but Aunt Letha's unveiled remarks left little doubt that this pinch-faced woman had been in on it. Aunt Letha turned her attention to me, and I tried not to wince. Her directness can be rough, even on those she might intend to protect.
Good thing you're pulling your hair back like that, she said. Makes that long hair look more professional. You need to meet Sylvie Garnett. She may have a wonderful opportunity for you. If you'd bothered to stop by this week, I'd have told you about it sooner.
My mother comes by her penchant for hard luck cases, honestly, though Aunt Letha is more formidable in her aid to the downtrodden. The downtrodden better be moving pretty quick, or Letha can steam right over them.
Drat, don't see her right now, but I'll introduce you. Whatever were you doing hanging around up at the lake this morning? Hattie, Vinya, Avery's here. Avery, you come by tomorrow. We need to go walking.
My other two great aunts joined us, rescuing me from further cross-examination. I really didn't want her asking me about the lake. We exchanged pleasantries, and I promised to get my mom and dad over for lunch after church. My great aunts didn't mention the submerged car or Don Lee's stunt, which boded badly for my reputation. Either they didn't know, which was unlikely, or the story circulating was so embarrassing they dared not mention it. Maybe they were still so embarrassed for me over the loss of my job, they hadn't had time yet to fret over how I'd managed to attract the attentions of Don Lee Griggs. Had anybody asked, I couldn't really explain the loss of my job. I still wasn't sure why I had snapped that day in court, listening to my own expert witness shamelessly perjuring himself to win my malpractice case. I play to win, but not at all costs. Not with an expert willing to stretch the truth beyond all recognition. I snapped. By the time I got through angrily goading Dr. Hilliard and he got through exploding, the judge declared a mistrial. The insurance company I represented settled with the injured baby's family, and I was out of a job. True, I should have controlled myself in court, but my reasons were too complicated to explain in casual conversation, so I just kept smiling and pretending along with everybody else in Dacus that nothing untoward had happened. As I looked around for Mom, Letha returned to grab my elbow and steer me at an alarming pace past clusters of dainty little ladies. I feared we'd topple someone over, bobbing as they must in Aunt Letha's wake.
Avery, you remember Sylvie Garnett?
We both nodded politely. Of course I knew her, in that way you know your parents' contemporaries. She looked a bit grayer and a tad shorter than I remembered her, a phenomenon I'd noticed since coming home. The whole town seemed older and smaller. Of course, Sylvie Garnett still stood taller than I, slender in a willowy way like my sister. She wore a rich red-orange Pendleton wool skirt. The matching sweater sported patchwork suede leaves. Her hair, brushed back from a well-defined widow's peak, lay in Queen Elizabeth steel-gray waves, and she carried herself with the rigid decorum I remembered.
Avery, I've been meaning to call you. We're so thrilled you've come back here to Dacus.
The words rolled off in a honeyed drawl that, this close to the mountains, had to be an affectation.
I understand they had some excitement up at Luna Lake this morning.
She smiled expectantly. I just smiled back. News did travel fast. When I didn't volunteer anything, she continued without looking too disappointed. My husband has been anxious to talk to you in a professional capacity. She leaned forward and tapped my forearm lightly.
something at the plant he has questions about. He's certain you'll know more about it than these local boys, you being with the Lincoln firm and all.
I'll certainly be happy to talk to him. I patted my blazer pockets as if searching for something. I didn't bring any business cards with me. Actually, I didn't have any cards. He can reach me at Carlton Barner's office.
Oh, her eyebrows raised. Are you going into practice with Carlton?
No, but he's been kind enough to give me the use of an office and his staff for a while. Whether Harrison Garnet would be able to reach me by calling Carlton's office remained to be seen. For some unspoken reason, Lou Ray, Carlton's receptionist, had developed a palpable dislike for me. Whenever we were out of his earshot, she all but growled and hissed. What she would do to a phone inquiry from Sylvie Garnet unsettled me a bit, but right now I had no alternative.
Actually, Sylvie said, the matter seems rather urgent. Something about an environmental inspection? I'm not really sure.
The shake of her head and the wave of her hand gave an unconvincing imitation of the uninvolved housewife.
Why don't you just stop by this afternoon? After the meeting here, of course. I'll call him and let him know you're coming. Looks like they want us to take our seats. You go by this afternoon.
She patted my arm again to punctuate those last words, then dismissed me by seeking out a seat with two women I didn't recognize. Aunt Letha had set sail for another part of the room, so I swerved by the refreshment buffet to snag something before I took a seat on the back row. With finger food, you have to choose carefully to get something substantial while not appearing gluttonous, although some of the ladies, their midsections uncomfortably harnessed by girdles and their swollen feet spilling over their Deliso Deb pumps, really packed away the cheese straws, pettifors, and mixed nuts without appearing self-conscious. When I joined her, Mom smiled reassuringly, artfully ignoring my chicken puff-stuffed cheeks. I had skipped breakfast. I also missed most of the program. Something about a new book on the diaries of a Confederate war heroine, tuning out the speaker and squelching any thought of the body at the lake, I focused on the immediacy of what might be my first serious client. Picking up an appointment through the guy's wife might seem an odd way to go about things in some places, but not in Dacus. The only thing I knew about environmental law involved recognizing it as a tricky, regulation-laden area. I'd spent my legal life as a malpractice defense litigator. But as of a few weeks ago, I'd started from scratch. Environmental law might be as good a place to start as any, and more interesting than wills, divorces, fender benders, and real estate closings, the meat and bread of small practice law. The thought of general practice terrified me. I'd been used to an elaborate support network of specialist lawyers, paralegals, a law library, computer research capabilities, and a billing office. I knew how to defend a medical malpractice case, but little else. Armed only with Carlton's receptionist, who'd obviously like to see me stuffed and mounted, I felt daunted. But that was only if I was candid with myself. I squirmed, not paying much attention to the speaker, a gray man with a light lisp. He garnered a pleasant titter from the audience at some anecdote of Civil War sexual politics. Not for the first time, I mused about exploring other career options. After all, I'd been given a fresh start, a clean slate. In my darker moments, I'd mentally practiced auditioning for some of those other options. "Would you like fries with that?" made my stomach clench, but "Hi, welcome to Walmart. Wouldn't be too bad." I kept returning to the same conclusion. Law school had left me completely unprepared for practically everything. My sister stays home, raising my niece and nephew, gardening, canning vegetables, cooking standing rib roasts, and sewing her own clothes. I'm domestically challenged by brown and serve roles. And seventh grade home economics had been the last time anyone let me near a sewing machine. While attempting to create a pair of hot pants, I'd stitched the cuff of my shirt to the left front and back of the shorts, then broken the needle and jammed the machine. in trying to free me while maintaining control of 20 home ec students armed with scissors and pins, my teacher almost burst into tears. Thinking back on it, she'd probably reconsidered her career options that day. She'd suggested I join the marching band, then she'd married the next May and quit teaching. I mentally skimmed past the marriage option. Law school had broken me of the dating habit. Few people have any idea the kind of people who go to law school, and practicing law broke me of the habit of any social life. So here I sat, in the Lutheran church social hall, accepting the fact that at the ripe age of 30-ish, I didn't have many directions in which to head. But at least I had an appointment with Harrison Garnett, sort of. I grabbed Mom and scooted out of the meeting as quickly as we could. "Sure you can borrow the van," she said. "Just drop me by the house. Oh, and can you take those aluminum cans by the fire station for their burned children project?" Bags of empty Coke and beer cans collected from taps filled the back of the van, rattling every time we stopped, started, or turned a corner. "I probably should put those things in your dad's truck. They do get a little pungent, don't they?" "You can't very well have Dad riding around with his truck full of beer cans. What would First Baptist Board of Deacons say?" Mom laughed as she parked the van in front of the house. "It'd be almost worth it to find out. Good luck. See you for supper?" "Sure, thanks." I crawled over behind the wheel, then wrestled my skirt back where it belonged. The matter-of-fact way my parents handle the most dramatic upheavals amazes me. Then again, they tend toward a flair for the dramatic in the most ordinary circumstances. Garnet Mill sat a couple of blocks off North Main Street, nestled into a neighborhood of small mill houses, a scattering of house trailers, and a few large old white clapboards, too, that offered rooms for rent. The grounds looked unkempt and unprosperous. Rust pocked the chain-link fence surrounding the parking lot, grass sprouted through the cracked asphalt, paint peeled from the metal doors of the loading dock. Inside, two green vinyl chairs sat on either side of a dusty plastic fern in the makeshift waiting area, and ancient gray-green metal desks furnished the business office. But the receptionist, who probably doubled as office manager, didn't park me there. She immediately ushered me past a half-dozen desks where three women of assorted ages talked on phones, typed on an old IBM Selectric, or pushed papers around. Mr. Garnett's office walls were painted a rosy taupe, and the cherry furniture hadn't come from the same army surplus sale as the desks outside. The subdued good taste evidenced Sylvie Garnett's hand at work here. Not flashy, not new, but it clearly drew a line between out there and in here. While Sylvie Garnett and her decorating taste had remained the same, Mr. Garnett had changed. I remembered him as a small man, slightly shorter than his wife, with a fringe of bright white hair circling his shiny head. I'd never seen him in anything but a dark gray suit, exuding an air of authority, a masterliness. None of that had changed. What had changed was the wheelchair he swung around his desk to greet me. "Mr. Garnett, it's so nice to see you again."
"Avery, my, haven't you grown up? Your dad keeps us posted on you and your sister at the Rotary meetings. Despite all his bragging, he didn't tell us how pretty you were."
I'm not used to talking to people shorter than I am. Feeling awkward, I fought the urge to bend over to address him and gratefully sank into the chair he motioned me toward.
"Thanks for stopping by. Sylvie told me you were in town. You may be just our answer for this little matter we're facing."
"I certainly hope I can be of help." I pulled out my leather notepad and Waterman pen, for some reason needing the comfort of familiar tools of my trade. "Perhaps if you could give me some background." Mr. Garnett rolled behind his desk. Seated behind the protective barrier of his desk, with the wheelchair out of sight, he looked more like the man I'd seen all my life, the owner of one of Dacus's largest employers. Garnett Mills produced cheap, upholstered furniture, a low-end operation with the kind of jobs that now often move to Mexico.
"In a nutshell, Avery, I've got some environmental boys coming tomorrow to audit my records, and they want to know, while they're here, if they can look around the plant site."
With thumb and forefinger, he lined up his desk blotter precisely with the edge of his desk. other than a brass lamp and a mahogany inbox, which sat empty, the desk lay clear of clutter. Either he was extremely organized, or he didn't have much to keep him busy.
"We're just a small-town operation and don't often deal with the environmental boys. I want to be protected. To tell you the truth, I feel a bit like a sheep waiting to be shorn."
He smiled disarmingly.
"I understand those boys can play hardball. I just want to make sure we're covered."
"I understand." I tried to sound reassuring, but I scarcely knew where to begin. "Have they served you with any papers? Do you know of any complaints, or is this a routine visit?" He shrugged.
"The guy called, wanted to know if he could come tomorrow afternoon. I assumed this was routine, but I wanted to make sure, you know, protect myself. You hear about these regulators running a police state."
I nodded. He probably spent his afternoons listening to conservative talk radio shows. "Best to be prepared. What sorts of records are you required to keep?" He looked puzzled, so I quickly added, "Do you use or store any hazardous materials on the premises?" He snorted politely.
"You mean other than the liquid correction ink the girls out front use? I understand that's toxic or hazardous or some such. We're supposed to keep paperwork on that. Can you believe it?"
"A material safety data sheet." I nodded and hoped I'd gotten the name right. "The paperwork can be quite onerous."
"You can say that again. Not sure how we're protecting the environment if we're killing all those trees for the paper to keep records on."
I nodded and pretended to jot myself a note. He continued, "Of course, we use glue."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.